Amsterdam is known worldwide for its infamous coffee shops, those shady little rooms where one may partake safely in the consumption of locally sourced jazz cabbage without fear of being arrested and having your life destroyed by an antiquated justice system.
Peace and disgrace.
The history of coffee shops is a story as hazy as my Monday morning memories, but most people will agree that the first coffee shop ever in Amsterdam was called Mellow Yellow. Now closed down by the government, it was once located here, behind that scaffolding behind me, on Wijzelgracht 33, where they first sold those dirty trees. But Mellow Yellow was set up in 1972, and this photo from a Dutch newspaper archive shows a couple of fellas looking at a couple of alligators in a coffee shop dating back to 1968, 4 years before Mellow Yellow even opened. So where the hell was the first coffee shop ever, I hear you ask? Or I presume you would ask. That's what I would ask. Well, to find that out, we're going to have to get out of Amsterdam entirely. Well, like, we don't have to. I could just tell you now, but that'd be shit. When the Dutch originally gave coffee shops the go-ahead back in 1976, they didn't do it because they're some big band of bongo-banging bong bandits, but because at the time it just seemed so blatantly obvious that weed would eventually be legalized across the continent that allowing the consumption of cannabis appeared to be the rational thing to do. The Dutch are rational people. The Dutch thought Europe would also be rational. The Dutch were very, very wrong. Because the Dutch never got around to actually legalizing cannabis, they instead ended up crafting an unusual compromise where they would just put their hands over their eyes wherever weed was being consumed.
I'm high as fuck.
And there's nothing you can do about it.
This little legal trick is called gedogen, where the police can see the offense taking place but just choose not to intervene.
Gedogen, when you realize that the system is broken and life's better when it's all out in the open. The Dutch cops know that the people have spoken, arresting young fellas for a smoke.
Are you joking?
Back in my country, the dope is verboten. A nice cup of tea and a smoke is enough to provoke some old cunt of a judge to treat you like a criminal instead of getting into the gedogen.
Pretty fucking cool. Which is why the Netherlands is in the unusual position where everybody knows it's illegal to sell cannabis, but everybody just pretends that it's not happening. But if you break any of the strictly enforced guidelines, then you're fucked. Three strikes, you're out. Essentially, you break the rules three times and you are never getting the license again.
I hold the microphone.
Oh, hell yeah, I'm just after bumping it.
Snoop Dogg, Shizzle, Jizzle, Rashid, the godfather, M.O.B., of course, set up on the Allah and on the Lord. Yeah, I hear that, man.
What's your name, brother?
My name is Rashid, man. Dr. Rashid, Mulay Rashid.
Rashid.
Tupac, Amaru Mulay Rashid.
Tupac.
Amaru Mulay Rashid.
My man.
You know Tupac, Amaru Mulay,
you know Tupac?
Rashid, Allahu Akbar.
You heard it here
Maybe
first,
the man
lads.
Wants to give me a small favor.
The man will give him a small favor. Oh, the man will give him a small favor. No problem.
Hi, guys. We apologize for the interruption to your service. Shy guides will be right back. Ooh, la, la, la.
As I was saying, before my business partner interrupted me, they don't just hand out licenses to every fucking stoner with a woolly jumper and dreams of selling a million grams of smoke to teenage French boys. Le coffee shop a license, monsieur. In the early 90s, there were 40 coffee shops in Utrecht. And over time, with the laws changing, this slowly got whittled down to 11. 10 of which are on land, and 1 which is on water. Feast your lazy, bloodshot eyes on coffee shop the boat. It's a coffee shop on a boat. And I'm fucking in it now, man.
Like boats,
cause I like boats. Oh, totes my goats, I love boats, boats. I like to go where the tide is low, to get high and stoned on a boat, boats. Cause I like boats, I like smoking, that's no joke. So do you wanna get stoned and float? Cause I know a boat where you can do both.
Coffee shop, the boat. It's a coffee shop on a boat. Well, bon appetit. Bellissima. See that editing? Now the camera has me over here. The boat itself dates back to 1905, but in 1986 it got turned into like a youth hostel. They started banging out hash to the guests, and eventually the city granted it a coffee shop license. It may not be the first coffee shop ever, and it's not the reason we're here, but I'm just after picking up a gram of sour power, I'm feeling nice. This is not the first coffee shop ever, but it is the first coffee shop ever on water. So to actually find the first coffee shop ever, we're going to have to walk back into the city center. So why not watch this poorly edited montage of the 60s while I walk there?
They dress in bizarre and colorful ways. They wear their hair long. Their very name suggests that they are hip, on to something good.
While the commune listens to a local group, some craftsman rolls a king-sized joint for the common good.
In 1968, the world was in turmoil. The old orders were collapsing and new youth movements were in search of new answers and new messiahs. And in Utrecht, that spot was filled by the orphaned son of a Rotterdam sex worker. Holly Hasenbos was just 22 when he went from dealing a little hash in a little music club to buying the place outright and turning it into a safe space where people could watch a band, have a drink, and get high as fuck. Word of this madhouse spread throughout the country, and an entire generation were introduced to the amazing ways of the haze. And the fabled place where they came to blaze went by the name of Sarasani. Back in the 60s, the lower canals would have been full of bars, cafes, maybe an old fucking jazz band playing a cheeky riff or two. All in all, pretty nice neighborhood. But the neighbors were definitely not ready for the day that Holly Hasenbos moved in. The circus was coming to town and every freak in Utrecht was invited. And right here is where they came. Number 327 on the Oudeklacht. The site of the world's first ever coffee shop. Perfect spot for an underground business. It's not actually here, it's underground, literally underground. So we're gonna go down and have a peep. This was hallowed ground for the lovers of freedom and happiness, and a thorn in the side for the tyrannical animals who want to lock up anybody who deviates from the norm. And believe me, this place deviated from the norm. Looks a little bit more normal now though. Gentlemen, having a lovely day. I'm here trying to visit the site of the world's first ever coffee shop. Obviously no longer here, no? More peaceful scenes here today. We got a cup of tea and a cat. Happy days, man. So this would have been the spot. This was where Sarasani was. You just had this door behind us here. There was a lot of trouble with the neighbors upstairs. People would be calling to 327 thinking they were at the coffee shop. So there was always going to be tensions with the neighbors. And yeah, this was the spot along the wharf here. The neighbors didn't really understand what the fuck was going on. Like a coffee shop, the concept had never existed before.
Remember that picture of the alligators? Well, they were fucking security alligators. Holly Hasenbos, being the absolute mad bastard that he was, kept his stash of hash in the middle of a concrete basin, protected by an assortment of exotic lizards. No wonder the poor neighbors upstairs were terrified about what was unfolding beneath their feet. Jesus.
If you can imagine, there would just be lines of hippies and freaky people lining up here trying to get in. The door would always be locked, so you'd have to knock. And if Holly knew you weren't a cop, if you looked freaky and smelly enough, you were going to get in. In 1971, three pythons escaped from the coffee shop. Two were found swimming in the canal. And a month or two later, one of the neighbors sat down to take a shite on a cold winter's morning, and out pops python number fucking three. Jesus. If you could imagine crowds of spaced out lulas and lunatics knocking on the door upstairs, I think
The actual house upstairs got attacked a few times, drug dealers putting in the windows, and just lunatics who didn't actually know where the coffee shop was. So this was really a thorn in the side of the decent, good living people of the Oudeklacht.
Holly Hasenbos, Holly, 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 Holly Hasenbos, Holly, 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 Holly Hasenbos, Hasenbos,
master of the cannabis.
Got the Cayman alligators hanging on the side.
Holly Hasenbos,
Holly, 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 Holly,
Holly Hasenbos, Holly Hasenbos, Hasenbos, master of Sarasani.
If you got the cash, come and holler at the hash bar.
He was back in a different time in the turbulent year of 68. The post-war nations and new generations of hairy barbarians at the gates. And the situation was spicy. The new type of life was enticing. To get mightily high and drift idly by, and to take on the high and the mighty. Ooh, having a bang. Something was happening in the canal. Like any hash in an Indian stash had arrived in the back of a rickety van. It was the yin and the yang, the youth of the day and the law of the land. When out there smoking, a difficult man with a different plan and a slip in his hands. His name was Holly Hasenbos, and he had fucking had enough to make the world better. He set up a cellar where you could have a puff and sew up a gun. The son of a gun was the trickle before the tsunami. Set up a shop in the Oudeklacht and called it Sarasani. Do you get many people coming here to have a look?
Yeah, it's a little bit less than it used to be, because when I just lived here, like once every day somebody would stop by.
Really, yeah?
The Sarasani open again.
Wow. Wow, man, I can't believe I actually got to come in. Wow, wow, wow. And do you know where the large, there was like a stone basin with the alligators and all this?
Over there.
It was right there. That is amazing. I can't believe I'm actually, very unusual that this. Oh, come on inside. And this was where the bands, I guess, were at the back.
Yeah. The floor was where they invited like Golden Earring, and they were really famous in Netherlands.
Yeah.
Started over here, so they...
That's wild, man. That is absolutely bananas.
So this is my normal bathroom. And here we have some... We're behind the garden. There's a garden. When Sarasani was still here, they had like 100 people inside, so they needed to have an escape route, so there's still an escape route here.
Unbelievable, so crazy.
Holly Hasenbos, Holly, 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 Holly,
Holly Hasenbos, Holly Hasenbos, Hasenbos, master of Sarasani.
If you got the cash, come and holler at the hash bar.
The freaky times kept on rolling, and the legend of Sarasani kept on growing. And in 1974, the city finally began making their first moves to remove the color from their dull gray world. They cancelled Sarasani's permit to sell booze, and Holly was arrested for the first time. But the city of Utrecht had no idea who the fuck they were dealing with, and so the legal saga of Sarasani began. Sarasani was raided, and Holly was arrested no less than 7 times, possibly a lot more. And every time he got arrested, he would get stuck right in here, in the Politiebureau am Paardenveld. After his first arrest, Holly was undeterred, and instead he actually redoubled his efforts, and he changed from just a businessman into more of like a political activist. The arrests became more common, and every time he ended up in here, he'd have to leave a little sign on the door of Sarasani saying, "Closed while I'm on vacation, you know where." He described the raids as like essentially an anti-terror brigade bursting through. Lads with double barrel shotguns, bulletproof vests, the whole fucking shebang. And when they would raid the shop, everybody would have to lie on the ground face first while they were searched. The opposite of chill. By this stage, Holly was an outlaw with a rock and roll lifestyle, a fan of fast cars and faster women. He started getting into all the rock star shit, started wearing leather pants, gold chains, all the good stuff. But he also, as time went on, became very political and started getting involved in a lot of protests. One, which was in the city hall here, the lad actually, he burst in and occupied
the mayor's office trying to call for the legalization of soft drugs. Absolute fucking lunatic. As the years rolled by, the heat got turned up on our old buddy Holly. Not only was he arrested all the time, but he actually had to spend 1.5 years as guests of the prison guards at Wolvenplein Penitentiary. This grim looking building behind the wall here. You can imprison a man, but you can't imprison his spirit. And as soon as he was released, Holly was back in the mix, banging out Moroccan hash, Thai weed, and good vibes. As far as Holly was concerned, Sarasani and the very idea of the coffee shop was here to stay. The 60s were long dead, the 70s had fizzled out, and now the 80s was announcing its crunchy arrival on the streets with the free flow of hard drugs such as cocaine and heroin. All this time at the forefront of the new movement had taken its toll on Holly. He wasn't only these days just, you know, rubbing shoulders with peace-loving hash smokers and regular police, but he was finding himself more and more at the center of controversy. And slowly but surely, he started descending into paranoid delusions, thinking that his house was being bugged, thinking the cops were coming for him, and thinking other drug dealers were about to attack him. This was no longer the rock and roll lifestyle of the 60s. On the night of July 17th, 1984, Holly was driving his famous red MG down this quiet little street here called El Sastrat, in a couple miles south of Utrecht city centre, when the cops pulled him over with the excuse of a dodgy backlight. He was used to being harassed by the police on the regular, but this time Holly had a trunk full of hash and a loaded magnum hanging on his hip. According to the police reports, Holly got blocked in by the cops and he tried to flee in his car. And when he couldn't get out, he panicked and drew his gun and shot at the cops through the door of his car. The police returned fire and 5 more gunshots rang out in this sleepy neighborhood, breaking the silence. His famous bright red MG was stained a darker, sadder shade of crimson. And at 36 years old, Holly Hasenbos exited the stage the same way he'd entered it, waking up the whole fucking neighborhood.
Holly Hasenbos,
halle, 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 halle.
Holly Hasenbos, Holly Hasenbos, Hasenbos, Master of Sarasani.
If you got the cash, come and holler at the hash bar.
After Holly's death, Sarasani kept banging out the music of peace, love and liberty. But this outpost of freedom came to a sad end when the law finally caught up with it. Since its arrival in 1968, Sarasani had been at the forefront of the fight against prohibition and had actually helped lead to the kind of policy of tolerance that the Netherlands was eventually to become famous for. But these laws were also going to lead to Sarasani's downfall.
In 2007, the new owners of Sarasani were caught selling 10 fucking kilograms to a German. And when the cops raided the houses related to Sarasani, they found another 40 kilograms. Sarasani lost their license.
So the city had finally done it. They defeated the forces of acceptance and closed down what should have been a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And the world grew a little greyer.
You can kill the man, but not the ideal. And one day, when the annals of freedom are finally written and adults are treated like adults, there will surely be a chapter dedicated to this little seller called Sarasani. So wherever you are, sit back and light one up for the pioneer, the legend, Holly Hasenbos.
Holly Hasenbos.
Holly, 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 Holly.
Holly Hasenbos.
Holly, Holly, Holly,
Holly Hasenbos.
Hasenbos.
Master of the cannabis.
Got the Cayman alligators hanging on the side.
Holly Hasenbos.
Holly, 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 Holly.
Holly Hasenbos. Holly Hasenbos.
Hasenbos.
Master of Sarasani.
If you got the cash, come and holler at the hash boss.